Hi all. Today we will start. We'll continue our third unit till magnetic tape we have discussed in the last video. Today we are going to see from associative memory. So the main objective of this associative memory is to reduce the time needed to find an item stored in a particular memory. And the main important things you should know about associative memory is it's not using any address to find out the data or the content. So the content is accessed by, the memory is accessed by content. That is why it is also known as content addressable memory. So I'll clarify it. That is, in order to find out a particular data item, usually we'll give an address. But in the case of associative memory, it is not going to give any address. It will give some words or part of the word to find out whether that word is present in the associative memory or not. So access the content of data without using address is known as associative memory or content addressable memory. Then there are read and write with associative memory. Read means to read a particular word, the content of the word or part of the word is specified. Then the memory locates all the words which match the specified content and marks them for reading. In the case of write, when a word is written in an associative memory, no address is given here. The memory is capable of finding an empty, unused location to store the word. Okay, so there are two tag values. Tag register value 1 indicates the active word stored in the memory. That is, that particular memory is having a word which is active. Tag register value 0 indicates now there is a particular location which doesn't have an active word, or there is an inactive word, so that position can be used for writing a new word. Next, about associative memory, which is more expensive than your main memory, because there is a cell to store the data. Along with that, there is a logic circuit which is implementing a matching logic with an external argument. So not only storing the data, it has some logic that is known as map logic. So because of this property, associative memory is more expensive than random access memory. Here we can see the hardware organization for associative memory. You can see the block diagram of associative memory. Here, the argument register having a word, we are finding out the matched word, or you can say with the help of key register, a word specified in the argument register is matched with the words in the associative memory. So you can see there is an associative memory array and logic. There are some input, read, write pins, and there are m words, and each word is having n bit. Okay, and finally, from the associative memory, there is again a match register connected. So what is happening here is we will specify a word in the argument register or part of the word. So this word, with the help of key register, it's going to get checked with the associative memory words, and if the words are matched, the match register value will be set to 1. If there is no match, the match register value will be set to 0. We'll see how the matching is happening with an example in the next slide. Here you can see an example. See, A indicates the argument register, K indicates the key register, and there are two words, word 1 and word 2. And here if you see, A is having a word 101, 1111 and 00. key register is very significant here because we will check the bit position of key register, or we will check the key register bits which are 1. The corresponding bits of argument register are compared with each word. The rest of the argument register bits are ignored. I repeat, the key register, which are the bits of key register are high or 1, only the corresponding bit position in the argument register are compared with the words in the associative memory. So you can see the key register having 111 and remaining all zeros. That is why we are comparing the argument register's higher order 3 bits 101 with the word 1 3 bits and word 2 3 bits. The reason now you know why it is only 3 bits. Now how it is going to check? A is having 101, word 1 is having 100. Actually the mapping is happening, individual bits are compared. Here the third bit is 0 for word 1. So there is no match. But in the case of word 2, both are 101. So each bit matches. So there is a match found. So whenever there is a match found, the match register value is set to 1. Okay, that is the main thing you should know about associative memory. Again, in detailed view of associative memory of M words and N cell per words, it looks like this. So each, you can see CIJ. CIJ, I is indicating the word number and J is the bit position in that word. So you can see there is a, it has explained word 1, word I, etc., word M. That means M words are there and each word is having N bits. That's the meaning. So you can see in word 1, C11, C1J, C1N. What is the meaning? C11 means first word, first bit. So like that, if you check, every depends upon the key bits values. First key also, they have represented like key bit, first bit, second bit, etc., n bits. So which are the bits of key register are 1, only such bit position, corresponding bit position of associative, sorry, argument register are compared with the corresponding bits of the bits of each word in the associative memory. When all such bits matching happen, and if all the bits are matched, then the corresponding word, each word is connected to a match bit M1, MY, MI, MM. So if word 1, all bits are matching happens, then M1 is set to 1. Otherwise, M1 is set to 0. I think now it's clear for you. Next, this is the logic circuit. What I said, associative memory, which are having cells to store the content, and there is a logic which is implementing the matching process. So this is one cell of associative memory matching logic circuit. So you can see there is a flip-flop RS which is used, which can store the word in the associative memory. It is represented by the storage element FIJ, and this storage element is connected to a match logic. So here match logic, they need an external argument register with the help of a key register. It is comparing this AJ value with FIJ, each bits. Then if the, how many bits we need to compare, that is decided by the key register bits which are high. Then finally, if there is a match happens, MI is set to 1, otherwise MI is set to 0. So this is only one cell. There are multiple cells in each word. This is the implementation for one cell of an associative memory. Now, the match logic can be implemented in two ways. One is neglecting the key bits, the other one is including the key bits. If you neglect the key bits, This is the logic Boolean function xj is equal to aj fij plus aj dash fij dash, where xj value can be 1 or 0 depends upon aj is equal to fij or aj not equal to fij. Finally, whatever such x, x1, x2, etc., xn values, pairs, we are performing AND operation of all such pairs of matched bits in a word to find out finally what we need to set for match bit MI. That is, with the neglecting the key bits we are not using. Next method is including the key bits. Here the key bit value KJ is equal to 0 means no comparison between the corresponding bits of AJ and FIJ. We have already seen whichever bit positions of key bits are 0, the corresponding AJ values are not compared with the FIJ. Here FIJ is the associative memory, words are stored in the this storage element FIJ. Then if KJ is bit position is equal to 1, J indicates each bit. So KJ is equal to 1, then that corresponding bits of AJ need to be compared with the FIJ. And the match logic equation XJ plus KJ dash, which can be XJ or 1, depends upon KJ value. How? If KJ value is equal to 1, then automatically KJ dash value will be equal to 0. So XJ plus KJ dash will be XJ plus 0, which is equal to XJ. Okay. When KJ is equal to 0, then KJ dash value, which is equal to 1. So the equation XJ plus 1, which is equal to 1. Finally, the match logic for word I in an associative memory can be expressed by the following Boolean function. That is, they are performing AND operation of the added result of XJ and KJ dash pairs. Okay, so that is the match bit setting. Now you can see a match logic for one word of associative memory. Previously, similar one diagram you have seen, which was the match logic circuit for one cell, and a word contains multiple cells. Here an example given, 101 is argument register value, 101 for key register value, and word 1 is 101 and word 2 is 100. That means it is a word of 3 bits. So a word have 3 bits. In order to store each bit, we need 3 cells. So each cell can store 1 bit. That is why in order to implement each cell, we need a logic circuit. So there are 3 bits. So 3 logic circuits are combined. That's all about associative memory. Next, we'll move on to cache memory. Cache memory works on the principle of locality of reference. What is locality of reference? That is a phenomenon in which a computer program tends to access same set of memory locations for a particular time period. That means if CPU refers to a particular location, now there is more chance of CPU referring the same location again and again. So that is the tendency usually seen. So that is why whatever locations already accessed may access in future too. So that is known as locality of reference. So cache memory works on the principle of that. And examples, we can see program loops which are executed. So whenever CPU, there are some loops, CPU repeatedly refers to the same set of instructions in memory. Again, in the case of subroutines, like we have procedures, we will call a procedure, we'll return from the procedure. That time, a set of instructions are fetched from the memory. So there also this locality of reference is applied. Now, you can see there is a basic operations of cache. There is a diagram. So here there are 3 steps. That is, one indicates You can see one is there is a connection between CPU and cache memory. That means CPU needs to access memory. So cache is checked. If that particular word is found in the cache memory, then CPU will read from the fast cache memory. Second one, if the first one fails, that is, if the word is not present in the cache memory, then the main memory is accessed by the CPU to read the word. Clear? And third one, suppose CPU accesses the main memory to get a particular data, that corresponding address data pair has to be transferred or moved from main memory to cache memory for future use. That is represented by number 3. Next, the performance of cache memory is decided by hit ratio. So we need to know what is hit and what is miss. If CPU refers to a particular memory and it finds that particular word in cache, it is known as hit. That is, whatever CPU is searching for, it is there in the, that particular data item is there in the cache, it is a hit. If the data item or the word is not found in the cache, then it is a miss. Then CPU will go and search the main memory to finding out as an alternative way. So you know about hit and miss. If the CPU refers a particular data which is present in the cache, it is a hit. If the particular data item is not present in the cache, it is a miss. So hit ratio is the number of hits divided by total CPU references to memory. So total CPU references are the combination of hits and misses. It can be hit, it can be a miss. That is just a CPU reference. So there is an example given here. Total 10 references has been made by the CPU, out of which 9 hit and 1 miss. So what is the hit ratio? Hit ratio is the number of hits divided by total number of CPU references. So you can see in the slide, it is number of hits. How many hits? 9 divided by number of CPU references. That is, it's a combination of hit plus misses. So 9 plus 1, 10. 9 by 10, 0.9 is the hit ratio. And what is the average access time? Average access time, how to calculate? Cache memory access time is equal to 100 nanosecond. Main memory access time is given as 1000 nanosecond. See, you can see the difference here only. Accessing cache will happen very fast. It will take more time to access main memory. That is why cache is very fast accessing memory. So here, they have given 100 nanosecond for cache memory access time and 1000 nanosecond for main memory access time. So what is the average access time, which is equal to 1 miss? So only 1 miss out of 10 references. So each miss 1000 nanosecond. So it is 1000 nanosecond. Then each hit 100 nanosecond. There were 9 hit. So 9 into 100, which is how much? 900. So 1000 plus 900, total 1900 nanosecond divided by total number of CPU references, 10 references, which is equal to 190 nanosecond. So 190 nanosecond is the average access time, because most of the items they got from cache memory. Only one item it didn't get from cache, which it got from main memory. Okay, cache access time is 100 nanosecond, but extra 90 nanoseconds needed here because of a miss happens. Clear? Next, we will see mapping process. What is meant by mapping process in cache? The transformation of data from main memory to cache memory is referred to as mapping process. So main thing you need to know, whenever CPU didn't find out a data item or a word from cache memory, CPU will refer main memory and it will find that data from main memory. So immediately that particular data address pair needs to be transferred from main memory to cache memory. For that particular reason, always main memory and the cache memory has to be up to date, like it should be same. So for that, to make it same, there is a process called a mapping is happening. There are three types of mapping procedure. One is associative mapping, second one is direct mapping, third one is set associative mapping. You can see there is an example for cache memory. So cache memory indicates 512 into 12, and that is 512 words. Each word is having 12 bits. Main memory 32K words, and each word is having 12 bit. Okay, so you can go to next slide. Yeah, we will explain associative mapping clearly. See here, associative mapping cache. All, first of all, you should understand the address is represented in octal numbers. So octal means each bit is encoded to 3-bit octal number. So CPU will always generate 15-bit address, which is given to an argument register. And there is an cache memory, and which is having address data pair. So whatever address is coming, CPU address is coming, that is a 15 bits address, we need to map that 15 bit address to a 12 bit data in the cache memory. Okay, that means a CPU address of 15 bits is placed in the argument register, and the associative memory is searched for the matching address. So if that address is found in the cache, that means the main memory, whatever data is there in the main memory, is there in the cache memory. Suppose that particular address is not present in the cache memory, then that address data pair has to be moved from main memory to cache memory. Here, one more thing, you can see 15 bits for address. So there are how many bits? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. First address is 0, 1, 0, 0, 0. There are 5 bits. So each bit is encoded into 3 bits of octal number. So 5 into 3, 15 bits. Here, in the case of data, 3, 4, 5, 0 corresponding to 0, 1, 0, 0, 0 address. So there are 4 bits. For each bit is again encoded into octal form. So 4 into 3, 12 bits of data. Next, suppose what I said, the argument register contain a 15 bit address, and this 15 bit address is searched in the cache. And if that address is found, that means that particular address data pair is already there in the cache. Suppose if that address is not found, and that means that particular address data pair has to be transferred from main memory to cache memory for future purpose. But if the cache is full, what to do? So if the cache is full, there are some address data pair which has to be replaced with the new address data pair coming from main memory. So that is known as cache replacement policy or replacement algorithm. An example is FIFO, first in first out replacement policy. No need to go in detail. You need to know there is a cache replacement policy and an example. And the drawback of associative mapping is it is more expensive compared to RAM. Why? Because the associative memory itself having a cell to store the data plus a logic circuit to implement the map logic. That's why. Next method is direct mapping. Here, the total n bits, you can see it is divided into tag and index. K bits of index and n minus k bits of tag. For example, CPU address 15 bit, 6 bits tag, 9 bit index, and this total n bits, that is tag plus index. These many bits are needed to address the main memory, but only the index bits are used to address the cache memory. Okay, here also we are using octal address. It is, each address is represented in octal format. So if you see the cache memory, 512 into 12, here it's more clear why it is 512 into 12, because there are 9 bit address bus. So 2 to the power 9, which is equal to 512 into data bus is 12 bits. So there are 512 words and each word is having 12 bits. In the case of main memory, how it is 32K? Because the address bus is 15 bits. So how many addresses are found or how many words are there? 2 to the power 15, which is equal to 32,000. And data bus is 12 bits. So 32,000 into 12, which is equal to 2 to the power 15 into 12. 32K into 12. And here you can see that address, octal address, 15 bit address is split into first 2 bits are tag, remaining 3 bits are index. Okay. And so index is enough for addressing the cache memory. How many bits? 3 bits. Sorry, 3 bits, which is equal to 3 into 3 9 bit address. But in the case of tag plus index, total n bits are needed to address main memory. We'll see how direct mapping is happening here. You can see there is a main memory addresses which are split into first 2 bits are for tag, remaining 3 bits are for index. And there are some data in each address. And you can see the diagram B, which is cache memory. Here the index addresses are used to address the cache. That is, index bits are used to address the cache. And each index is having a tag bit. So what is happening is, whatever address coming from main memory, that index value will give which is the particular location in the cache. And if they found a particular address in the cache through the index bits, that corresponding tag bit of that particular index is compared with the tag bit in the memory address. If both tags are same, that means there is a hit. So that cache or memory already having the corresponding data which is there in the main memory. Suppose there is a tag mismatch happens, then that particular address data pair has to be moved into cache memory. I repeat, if you can see 1, 2, 3, I can explain the last one, that is data is 6710 and the address is 02777. 02777, that is, it is a 15 bit address which is again divided into 6 bit tag and 9 bit index. This index is 777 and the tag in that index is 02. So what will happen if an address is coming from memory? This 777, it is going and finding out that is the correct particular address in the cache. If they found 777, that corresponding tag which is given in the memory address 02 and this 02, if there is a match, that means that is the correct data address pair which is there in the main memory is there in the cache. If suppose the tag is different, see, you can see fourth address in the main memory is 01777. See, it is index is 777, but its tag is 01. If you search in this particular example, they will find out the index, that is the cache address. And if they check the tag, here the tag is 02 and the address in the memory addresses tag is 01. That means that particular data is not there in the cache. It is a miss. So what will happen next? That particular address data pair is transferred from main memory to cache memory for future purpose. Here the disadvantage of direct mapping is hit ratio can be dropped. So hit ratio will decide the performance of the cache memory. Why? Because two or more words whose addresses can have the same index but different tag value. I have already explained you in the previous slide. If you check, Here an example, if you check the word at address 0 is presently stored in the cache 000 index and 00 and its data is 1220. But if you check, that means the first address 00000, its index is 000 and the tag is 00 and its data is already present. But if you check again, 0 first, second, third, fifth address, memory address 02000. That 000 is address, but its 02 tag is not present. For the corresponding index 000, that means it is not present. Now CPU now wants to access the word at address 02000 means it is going and checking the cache, it is a miss because it is not present. So that means there will be same indexes with the different tag values. Okay. Now again, direct mapping is implemented with blocks here. That is one more method in direct mapping. Here, what is the difference is, again, the index part is divided into block and word. So there were 15-bit CPU address and the 16 bit is divided in, sorry, 15 bits are divided into 6 plus 6 plus 3. So 6 bit of tag, 6 bit of block, 3 bit of word. Now you can see there are 64 blocks of 8 words each. You can see block 0, block 1, etc., block 63. Each block is having 8 words and in each block the tag value is same. Okay, its data is different but tag value will be same. So here this is how the block direct mapping cache with the block have been implemented for a 512 word cache. There are 64 blocks. Each block is having 8 words. So total 64 into 8, which is equal to 512 word cache. That's the meaning. Next is set associative mapping. An improvement over the direct mapping organization is set associative mapping. Here, a cache can store two or more words of memory under the same index address. So here, the same index, you can see the figure 12-15, index 000 having tag 01 and tag 02, both are contain different data. So that is a solution. Before it was a problem. Now they have solved using it's a capability, or it can store two or more words in the same index with a different tag value. So the number of tag data items in one word of cache is known as set. So you can see the memory addresses given 00000. And here we have 01000. So they can store, or 02000. These are the addresses. So here an example given for 01000 having 3450 and fifth address 02000 having the data 5670. So they have just given one index with a different tag value and you can store multiple words in the same index itself. Now the advantage of set associative mapping is hit ratio will improve as the set size increases. So suppose here an example index, each index there are two words, but they can store in one index three words or four words. That is, the set size can be increased as the set size increases, hit ratio also will improve. Okay, but the disadvantage is, as the set size increases, the number of bits in words of cache, that will be more. So that needs more complex comparison logic. That is one disadvantage. Next, have already said, in cache memory, if there is a cache miss, that means the particular data address pair from the main memory has to be transferred into cache memory for future purpose. But if the cache is full, then already existing some address data pair from the cache has to be replaced with the new address data pair coming from the main memory. So these are the different replacement algorithms, least recently used, least frequently used, first in, first out. Just you need to know the names. Next is writing to cache. There are two ways. One is write through. The second one is write back. What is write through? It's very simple. Writing to cache and writing to main memory is happening simultaneously or parallel. So both are same. The data, whatever data address pair in the main memory and cache are same. Or we can say cache is keeping up to date. Second one is write back. Here, cache will be updating every time, but main memory is not updated every time. Main memory is updating during some regular intervals of time. That is write back. Next is cache initialization. How cache is initialized? When power is applied to the computer, when main memory is loaded with the complete set programs from secondary memory, and there is a valid bit which indicates whether or not the word contains in the cache are valid data or not. So that's about cache memory. Next, we are moving to a new topic, that is virtual memory. So virtual memory, which is a concept used in some large computer system, and mainly the virtual memory or virtual mapping is happening between auxiliary memory and the main memory. Okay, so this virtual memory, which is used to give the programmers the illusion that they have very large memory at their disposal, but actually they are having small main memory. So what is happening is, as I said, all the data cannot be stored in the main memory. It will be there in the auxiliary memory. Whenever it is required, it is moving from auxiliary memory to main memory. So programmer will feel that all this data is coming from the main memory. Actually, whenever it is required, it is moving from auxiliary memory to main memory. So our main memory capacity is still small, but auxiliary memory having more capacity. Then here we have to see some terms. The address used by the programmer is known as virtual address, and such addresses are set of such addresses are address space, and the address in the main memory are physical address, and set of such addresses or locations are known as memory space. So virtual address and address space for programmer, physical address and memory space for the main memory. Now you can see there is an auxiliary memory where the programs and data resides, and there is main memory, and whenever it is required, the data can be moved from auxiliary memory to main memory. And one more thing, here an example. The address field of the instruction code has a sufficient number of bits to specify all virtual addresses. In this example, 20 bits are used to represent the virtual address. So since there are 20 bits, 2 to the power 20, that is 1024K words are there in the auxiliary memory. You can see a memory table for mapping a virtual address. previous slide, I said there is a 20-bit virtual address. So this 20-bit virtual address has to be mapped to a 15-bit main memory address. That is known as virtual memory mapping, and which is done with the help of a memory map table. And this memory map table having some entries, and that entries will give the corresponding data. So finally, the 20-bit address is mapped to a 20-bit address of virtual address is mapped to a 15-bit main memory address. Here, the virtual the auxiliary memory, which is divided into pages, and the main memory is divided into blocks, but both are fixed size. This diagram indicates at a given time, up to 4 pages of address space may reside in main memory in any one of the 4 blocks. That means any of 4 pages can be kept in the main memory, any one of these main memory blocks. Which page in which block is decided by the mapping technique. Now you can see a memory table in a paged system. Here there is an example, virtual address has 13 bits here. And this 13 bit, the first 3 higher order bits represents the page number. This page number is given to, which will give the, these page numbers give the corresponding block number. Why? Because we don't know which page is located in which block. So this page number 101, which is telling that this page 101, which is stored in block 01. Okay. And each the page table having a field called presence bit. The presence bit specifies whether the page has been transferred from auxiliary memory into main memory. That means if the presence bit value is equal to 1, indicates the mapping has already done. That is, the particular page has been transferred from auxiliary memory to main memory. That means this particular page is present in the particular block of main memory. If its presence bit value is 0, indicates still that particular page is not loaded into a particular block of main memory. So what is the remaining line number, which is same as the address space, main memory address space. So we will see this 101, which is the page number, which is giving the block number 01, and it is present in the main memory. That is why presence bit value is equal to 1. That is, if you see this example, the pages 1, 2, 5 and 6. You can see page 1, 001. Then page 2 means 010. Page 5 is 101. And page 6 is 110. Which are available in main memory blocks 3. Which is 3, 1, 1. 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1. 2 10 respectively. That is how the mapping process is happening here. Next is associative memory page table. Here, what's happening is a virtual memory address is placed in an argument register. Same, the virtual memory address contains page number and line number, and the page number is checked with the associative memory page numbers with the help of a key register. And if the page number is found, then the corresponding block number is fetched. That means that particular page has been already transferred from auxiliary memory to main memory. To which block? To block 1. That is 01 means 1. Then next we need to know what is a page fault. Page fault means a page referenced by the CPU is not there in the main memory. That is, a CPU is searching for a particular page in the main memory and the page is not found, which is known as page fault. So what is the solution? That new page has to be transferred from auxiliary memory to main memory. So for this, sometimes if the main memory is full, needs to replace some pages of main memory with this new page from auxiliary memory. That is known as replacement algorithm. There are some algorithms like FIFO, LRU are used for page replacement. Next is memory management unit. The main function of memory management unit is to map the logical address into physical address. For that, we need to know this memory what is logical address and what is physical address. Before that, this I'll tell you, memory management unit is a collection of hardware and software procedures for managing the various programs residing in a memory. And the components are address mapping, common program sharing, program protection. And here I'll tell you what is logical address. Physical address is, you know already what is physical address is a main memory address. What is logical address? For that, we need to know, till now we've said pages and the blocks both are fixed size. The auxiliary memory is divided into pages and main memory is divided into blocks. Here new thing or concept is coming called segment. What is segment? We are dividing the programs, a logical division of programs known as segmentation, and this divided parts are known as segments. The segments are variable sized. So the logical address is the address generated by such segmented program. Examples, a subroutine, an array of data, table of symbols, users program, etc. So the address generated by such segmented program is logical address, and the address in the main memory is physical address. Mapping of logical address into physical address is the function of memory management unit. So you can see there is an example, logical address format, physical address format. If you see the physical address format, there are 12 blocks having 12 bits, and you can see 12-bit block can give 2 to the power 12, 4096 blocks, and word is having 8 bit. That 8-bit words can give 2 to the power 8, 256 words. That is the case of physical address. If you see figure A, logical address format, logical address is, the format is 4-bit segment, 8-bit page, 8-bit word. It's an example for 20-bit logical address, and 4-bit segment, total 2 to the power 4, 16 segments are possible. 8-bit page, 2 to the power 8, 256 pages are possible. 8-bit word, 2 to the power 8, 256 words are possible. So the logical address, which are having segment field specify segment number, page field specify the page within that segment, and word field specifies the word within that page. There is a segmented page mapping numerical example. Here you can see the mapping of logical address into physical address is done with the help of a segment table and a page name table. Till now we were using only page table, but here this is segmented page mapping. So in addition to page table, we are using segment table. See, here an example. You can see figure A, logical address assignment. And here the hexadecimal addresses. This is how many bits are there? 5 bits. 6, then 4 zeros. So it is hexadecimal, so each bit is encoded into a 4-bit hexadecimal number. So there are 20 bit totally, 4 into 5. sorry, 5 into 4, 20-bit hexadecimal address, and each address will give the page number. So our aim is, generally, we will get a page number. Sorry, we will get a segment number. That segment number will give the page number. That page number will give the corresponding block number. And that block with the word will give the exact physical address. We'll see. The logical address, first one is segment number, it is 6. And the page number is 02. And 7E is the word. So, the 6 which is going and searching the segment table, and 6 is a segment number which is found, the corresponding 35 which is the page number entry, and this 35, if they go and search in the page table, before that, if we search 35, we'll get wrong. So this 35 plus the page number value 2 which is specified in the address 02, this 35 plus 2 which is equal to 37 is the actual page number in the page table. That will give a block number 019. That means this page 37 is stored in the block 019 in the main memory with the word 7E. So the total is 0197E. That address will give the 32-bit word. So you can say the segment 6 having the page number 37, 35 plus the page number 2, which will give 37. That page number will give the block number 019, which is containing the word 7E. That's the meaning. That is how the mapping is happening. These are the further explanations of the same thing. You can see that it will be easy to understand. And here, a memory reference from CPU will require three accesses. One is to access the segment table. The second one is to access page table. The third one is to access the main memory, which would slow the system significantly when compared to the conventional systems. So in order to avoid this or to increase the speed, fast associative memory is used to hold the most recently referenced table entries. That means no need to refer the page table from the segment table. Already most recently referenced table entries are stored in a memory known as translation look aside buffer or TLB. So what will happen is the segment number which will give the page number, that page number we no need to go and search in the page table. Directly that corresponding page and the block we will get from the associative memory, which is storing the recently referenced segment number, page number and the block. So that will increase the speed. This is the last topic of third unit, memory protection. Memory protection can be assigned to physical address or the logical address. So mainly the content of each entry in the segment table or a segment register is called a descriptor. So here we have base address, length and protection. The length field gives the segment size. What is segment size? It specifies the maximum number of pages assigned to segment. Okay, and that will be used for checking the size violations. Then the protection field in a segment descriptor, which specifies the access rights to a particular segment. What are the access rights? Protecting the program residing in the memory. These are the access rights. Whether full read and write privileges are there, that means there is no protection. Read only means there is write protection. Execute only, that means program protection. And system only means operating system protection. So this is about memory protection descriptor and different fields. I hope you have understood the topics in third unit. If you have any queries, please let me know. Thank you.